because they are making 200 million people feel happy at the cost of 2.5 million people in these producing countries such as India and China. This is how I'm going to do my reply speech today. Number one, I'm going to weed out the non-issues that have been prevalent in today's debate. Secondly, I'm going to do a stakeholder analysis on three different levels and how we've tackled all of that. And thirdly, on the very simple that whose side actually proved their position better. So without further ado, let's move on to the non-issues first, right? Because there are two of them, and it's very problematic when both these non-issues are their main examples. Number one, they talk about committing suicide. We've already read it out from the very beginning. The committing suicide was never because of these workers' rights that they so-called talk about. These people commit suicide because of depression, and depression is going to be further exacerbated under their side if they stop them from investing, if they stop these MNCs from investing in the country of origin. Secondly, as a chemistry student, I feel personally insulted when they talk about benzene, right? On how these people inhale benzene and they die. First of all, benzene is not a carcinogen, so we have to get that up. Secondly, you don't find benzene in the making of iPhone, so we do not know where benzene came up from, or we just think that they need to find a fancy chemical to actually make it sound fragile. But secondly, let's move on to the main issue of my reply speech on the stakeholder analysis, right? On three different levels. Number one, on the neighbor itself. Whose side actually supports that? Because their main claim was that we are evil idiots who actually don't want to support the laborers. We want to ensure that they are enslaved for our benefit. But we never said so. We simply said that their case is flawed because it doesn't solve the problems in the very beginning. Because you have to understand what these laborers want at the end of the day. Why are there still lines queuing up to the interview centers in Foxconn and all these companies that are so-called abusing them? Because they understand that in order to actually get a work there is the most important thing that they can find, instead of actually having to suffer in their words like benzene poisoning or all this stuff. Because you have to understand that when you, as a laborer, you need to find a job in these developing countries, and job is of an essential need to them, not on the working conditions. We concede that they need good working conditions, but it will never come under their side, because what they are doing is they are creating a lot of job opportunities. Because when these countries, they are forced to actually rethink the policy and readjust the policy, they will simply move away to another country, because they are always demand for this form of sweatshops and for this form of actually companies to actually build them. Like my previous speakers have already said, South Africa, India, they are always there. So what they are doing, they are not solving the problem, they are moving the problem to another country, which is not the aim of their side, right? But secondly, they talk about the MNCs on how they only provided one example throughout this debate, Apple and Foxconn, right? But we really provided to you a lot of them. For example, Pfeiffer, for example, Novartis, for example, Samsung and Apple, right? We said that what is the main motive of this MNC? Something that side government never truly understand. Their main aim is not about the welfare of the people. Their main aim was always about the profit. And we said that, will they actually readjust the policy so that they will actually think of the human rights? We say no. At the end of the day, what it's going to cost is for them to actually move to another country, like what we have always repeatedly said. Because you have to understand that the reason that they can actually abuse these people is of the loophole in the rule of the government itself. And we have already asked them whether or not changing the rule of the country or changing the policy of the government is going to solve, or the MNC is going to solve it. They have to understand that the government themselves have to take the initiative to make sure to cover up this loophole so that the MNCs cannot abuse them. We have to understand the government is the one that's responsible to the cost problem that their side is painting to you today.
Yeah.
But thirdly, right on the consumer's right, we believe that these consumers like you and I, we always have this right to actually purchase what we want, and we believe that it's a very gross encroachment under their side when we have done nothing wrong. Because I've already illustrated to you the concept of social contract and how you give up certain of your rights to actually enjoy this. And we believe that there is no breach of this form of rights from our side to actually be treated like this from the government. Because you have to understand, the side government is always supposed to be responsible for their own people and not for people on the other side. Sure, you can tell them that, look, I don't agree with your policy, please change it. But does it mean that you can actually change your economy and focus your whole trade just to actually make them change? We believe that it will never come, it will actually make things worse, right? But lastly, on the burden, their side has never proven to us on how their policy is going to solve the very problem that they're talking about. Their whole case has been a problem solution mismatch from the very start. But our side, we've already shown you a very simple stance. We consider that there is a problem, but the problem does not come under their policy. In order to solve this, you need organic change, and organic change has nothing to do with this form of section that they are talking about. With this side, our position takes the case.